Alek's world had become a blur of fear that stole his breath. Enclosed spaces with clear walls, shouts of human words he only half understood, and pain. There was a dully throbbing pain all over from the merman being dumped onto decks, dragged and shoved into these two small enclosures. Tanks, they were called. The water felt wrong. It was too warm, stifling. He struggled for every breath, his gills working twice as hard to take in half as much oxygen. It sapped him of his strength, and he could only lie there, unable to fall asleep and escape this nightmare for fear he'd stop breathing entirely if he did. These tanks were too small. There was no way to stretch out or get comfortable. He shifted and squirmed, his tail always ending up curved in some way. The ground was hard, no soft sand or gentle seagrass to lie in. His muscles soon cramped and ached. A lid was placed over the top, blocking out the sky, and with it, all hope of escape. He was forced to lie there, sore body curled up uncomfortably while bruises bloomed across his pale skin. Sick and weary from struggling to keep breathing, and so very frightened. Now the humans are taking him somewhere. The movement makes the water in the tank slosh around and makes his stomach queasy. Alek can feel the sea growing farther away, and his heart aches. Will he ever see it again? Will he ever swim freely? Or is he going to die like this, held captive by cruel men? After a while, the movement stops. There are more human voices, muted by the glass separating the mer from them. He can make out their blurry shapes, hands waving and pointing to him, eyes peering in at him. He's too weak to snarl at them. He only blinks back, hoping that just maybe one will take pity on him. They don't. All at once his world shifts. The tank is lifting up. He tries to grab onto something, anything, but his hands only slide over the smooth glass. He falls gracelessly from the confines of the tank, but not to freedom. His already bruised back hits the inside of the new tank with a painful thud.
Careful, you'll damage it!
Alek doesn't have a chance to catch his breath or do more than groan before water is being poured over him, filling the tank. He curls up, facing away from the humans, and lets it surround him. This tank is no bigger than the last. The water is a little better. He doesn't quite feel like he's suffocating, but it's still much too warm. The humans shove the tank, along with Alek, into a big, empty room and slam the doors, leaving him in darkness. Now he can no longer see the ocean or the sky, or much of anything. Chest tight with fear, the merman curls up in the corner and wraps his arms around himself. The room he's in begins to move, the ground beneath him rumbling. Alek closes his eyes. It's impossible to truly sleep with the rumbling movement of his container and the fear that grips his heart, but he manages to lull himself into a temporary calm, humming quietly, with eyes squeezed shut, wishfully pretending the rumble and the rocking water is nothing more than a storm that will pass. He's stirred back to awareness by a high-pitched wailing sound from outside. He glances up, but still only sees darkness. The room he's in slows and then stops. There are slamming sounds from outside, and then more muffled human voices. He wishes he could hear what they're saying, and if it has to do with him and where he's going. Suddenly, there are more slams, and shouting. The room his tank is in shudders and jolts, and suddenly it's moving again. Fast! He's thrown against a side of the tank with a cry, as his shoulder hits the glass. The water in the tank sloshes relentlessly, and it truly is like a storm now. The only thing keeping it in is the tight lid on top. The room jerks violently this way and that. There's nothing for him to grab onto, no way to steady himself, and so he's tossed back and forth with it, slammed around between the hard walls. He's breathless, dizzy, hurting all over.
I can't take it. Make it stop, please. Make it stop.
It never seems to end. Alek thinks he's either going to be sick or knocked out, hoping it's the latter. At least then he wouldn't have to endure this madness. He can't even get a second to catch his breath. Just when he thinks it couldn't get worse, the doors to the moving room fly open. He can see the world outside rush by, an unfamiliar blur of strange shapes and no ocean. Something tilts, and Alek realizes with growing dread that it's the tank, sliding across the floor, slowly, towards the open doors.
No!
The whole room lurches, and suddenly the tank is over the edge. There's a moment of weightlessness until... Alek goes tumbling across a solid rough surface. He skids to a stop with a groan, sprawled heavily on his chest on the ground. He closes his eyes, head spinning. The world comes back into roaring focus all at once. Every inch of his body lights up with pain, sharp pains, from shards of the broken tank embedded in his soft skin and fragile scales, a burning in his shoulder that flares if he moves it even the slightest, his scraped tail twitching with many scales broken and torn, soreness all over his body from being tumbled around in the tank. He's racked with violent shivers, noticing that the air is cold, especially after the overly warm tank water he was just in. It hurts so much, everywhere, all at once that he finds he can't breathe.
No, wait! I can't breathe because I'm not in water!
He tries to take in moisture with his gills, but comes up empty. He's so overwhelmed with pain and fear that it takes his lungs a second to kick in. He wheezes, and finally manages to take in some air. It's hardly enough. And the failure to breathe properly on top of everything else makes misery wash over him as he lies there, lost, hurt, and broken. A low whine escapes his lips and he curls up, gasping harshly when even the slightest movement hurts. Through the haze of pain, he begins to notice things. Sounds. Near him, mumbles and footsteps and strange slams and clicks. Distant rumbles, honks, and screeches. All of it terrifyingly unfamiliar. Slowly, Alek places his palms to the ground. He flinches at how hard it is on his sensitive skin, hard and cold on the dark gray rock. He shakily props himself up so he can look around. Lights everywhere! The sky is dark, but there are so many lights, some white and blaring, some high up and colorful. He blinks rapidly against them, trying to see more. Slowly, shapes and shadows emerge from the blur of light, shapes of buildings and vehicles and people. Humans have stopped and gathered around him, staring. Some are holding small, flat things, pointing them at him, little lights flashing from them. One lifts the flat thing to their ear and speaks into it quickly. The mumbling begins to take form, words that he can now clearly make out.
What is that?
Touch it. No, you touch it.
Do you think that can understand us?
He's gotta be fake, right?
Alek stares back, eyes pleading. It was humans who did this to him in the first place, but now they seem to be his only hope. Yet, none of them move towards him. Trembling, he looks around for water. Any water at all. He finds none, but does spot a gap in the cluster of humans. In a moment of desperation, he begins to drag himself towards it. It's short-lived. His tail drags across the rough ground and he gasps, high and broken, at the painful scrape of it. He lowers himself back to the ground, only to keen when another shard of glass digs into his side. With a hitched sob, he gives up and slumps down, shivering, his face hopelessly buried in his arms. In the distance, there's another high-pitched sound that pierces him down to his core. He cringes and covers his ears, a headache forming behind his eyes, pounding relentlessly.
So loud! It hurts! I'm so cold! Make it stop, please!
The human footsteps draw closer, and he can only flinch as unfamiliar hands tentatively prod at him. He squirms, trying to shake them off.
Don't touch me!
The awful sound draws closer and closer, and if he didn't have to use every remaining bit of energy to remain breathing, he would have screamed. It stops. Slams and footsteps are heard, and words that he's too dazed now to try to decipher. However, one voice cuts through it all, clear and calm.
Everyone, move back! Give him some space!
The cluster of humans back away, and Alek hears a new set of footsteps walking straight up to him.
Poor thing. You're far from home, aren't you?
There's a rustling of fabric as the human kneels down. Alek braces himself for fear he'll be grabbed again and dumped into another tank. Instead, a soft, gentle warmth envelopes his upper body and wraps around him. It's something cloth, heavy and dry, but warm. The merman lifts his head and peeks his tired eyes up, wheezing little breaths falling from his lips. The human's eyes meet his. These eyes aren't like the others he's seen. Appraising, judging, cruel, or even curious. They're kind. She smiles.
Don't be afraid. We're going to help you.
Her hand touches his hair, and Alek's eyes flutter shut at the first gentleness he's felt this entire horrible day. His aching body relaxes, exhaustion taking over. The human guides his head to rest in her lap. He loses himself in the comfort of the warm blanket, the soft lap, and the gentle hand in his hair. As the comfortable veil of sleep falls over his weary mind and body, he catches a few words from the human, the best words he might have ever heard in his life.
Let's get you back home.
Yeah, when you told me, oh, won't you be free? Free. Oh, if you could feel everything that I've seen. I know this is different, far away in this street. And this is what I'm standing on top of. This is just your dream and hope that we could believe in. But I'm caught in the moment and wait till you see it. The world that we've dreamed of. The roses are bleeding. Never not believing. I know you believe that this is what dreaming is. This is what being is when you.